Our gospel reading this morning tells of Jesus feeding 5,000 people with just a few fish and some bread. Jesus works a miracle. Using what was shared by those present, Jesus shows that when we are willing to share our gifts, God is able to do more than we could ever imagine. The scripture is from Matthew 14, 13 through 21. Now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat and to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate, and all were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children.
Would you be with me in prayer? Spirit of the living God, we give you thanks for your word spoken among us in Scripture, still speaking to all of us. We pray that your word would fall afresh upon us today and make the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, I've lived in the inland Northwest for a little over a year now, and I try very hard not to be an insufferable East Coast person. I've learned to temper my expectations on the highway and in traffic. People here just take their time. That's okay. I've lived in the Midwest and now the Northwest, and I've had the opportunity to spend time in multiple places around the country and around the world, and I really pride myself on not being provincial and elitist, as many people from the Northeast are perceived to be. But there is one thing that I will defend to the last, and I don't care if people say that I'm a snob or that I'm being overly dramatic, and that is the culinary miracle commonly referred to as the bagel. The bagel originated in Polish Jewish communities and has become associated with New York City. New Yorkers will tell you that you cannot get a good bagel outside of New York City because a proper bagel that is a bagel at all has to be boiled in New York City tap water. Otherwise, it won't taste right. Now, I will not go that far. I've had bagels from New York City, and they're very good. I've also had a very good bagel in Newton, Massachusetts. I've had a relatively good bagel in Chicago and a very good bagel in Skokie, Illinois. And I can say with great joy that I have had a fantastic bagel in Spokane, thanks to my friend Noah, who runs Viva Ultra Bread. He was just featured in The Inlander, so I feel justified in loving his bagels. And Montreal, Quebec, believe it or not, has its own version of a bagel that is different and unique, but absolutely stellar. I've also had a lot of bad bagels. And outside the Northeast, I've had a lot of people rave to me about a bagel that they like, only to taste something that is what I like to call a roll with a hole. See, a good bagel has a proper crust on the outside. It forms when it's boiled and then baked. And it remains fluffy and soft inside because the boil creates that crust that holds the moisture in. It's got this skin around it. And I also have strong opinions about bagel flavors. I'm a bit of a classic person. Sesame, poppy, everything, onion. Those are okay, but no berries, please. Nothing like that in my bagels. No, thank you. But the most important thing about a bagel, a good bagel, is that it needs to be fresh. When you go to a bagel shop and get a fresh bagel, you don't toast it. To toast it would just dry it out. It's still warm from the oven. It's still got that nice crisp crust. The perfect bagel is when you, the one that everyone should experience once in their lifetime, I think, is this. And you should seek this out if you can. A freshly baked everything bagel. Chive cream cheese. Thinly sliced tomatoes, red onion, cucumber, a little bit of lox or smoked salmon, and some capers. That, in my mind, is about as good as it gets. There is nothing I would rather eat on any morning. Now, Jesus didn't know a thing about bagels. Personally, part of me questions the wisdom of becoming incarnate before bagels existed, but that's another conversation. Jesus didn't know a thing about bagels, but he knew something about the essence of bread and the realities of fish in a culture before refrigeration. Bagels need to be fresh, and so when you get them, you share them. You eat them as quickly as you can. You don't hoard them. Fish doesn't keep well either. Of course, there are ways to preserve fish. Local indigenous communities would harvest massive amounts of salmon, and then it would be smoked and preserved and eaten for months. Now, preservatives and modern refrigeration have made it much easier to keep food around. You can go to Costco and get massive quantities of food that is shelf-stable for years. There are freeze-dried meals at REI that say Best Buy 2053. Jesus didn't have the luxury of that kind of abundance and that kind of predictability. He's met with a hungry group of people. And they aren't begging for food. Scripture doesn't say they're begging for food. It's not as if the people are on the verge of some sort of an angry riot or anything. It's just that he sees that they are people and that people need to eat and it's getting late. And so Jesus feeds them. Rather than sending the disciples into town on a sort of Costco run, Jesus chooses to feed them with what they have at hand, and a miracle happens, as so often does with Jesus. As they start breaking the bread and the fish and they start handing it out, everyone keeps eating until they're full. And then there's food left over, more food than they started with. I think what Jesus does is pretty cool. But there are a lot of people who would criticize him. Some would call what Jesus does charity, and charity has become kind of a bad word in our culture. A lot of people would point out that the people Jesus fed are just going to wind up hungry again tomorrow. If you give a person a fish, they eat today. If you teach them to fish, they eat for a lifetime. So why didn't Jesus teach these people how to fish? He's standing there on a lake shore, one that was probably brimming with fish, but instead he feeds them. I saw a poster this week that sort of riffed on that idea of feeding someone for a day or a lifetime. Some of you may have heard this. It was an organizing poster. It said, "If you give me a fish, you have fed me for a day. If you teach me to fish, you have fed me. Until the river is contaminated and the shoreline seized for development. But if you teach me to organize, then whatever the challenge, I can join together with my peers and we will fashion our own solution. I like that quite a bit. I think there's a lot of truth and a lot of wisdom there. I think it's good to give people fish because people get hungry and need to eat, and it's really nice. It's a joy when you can feed someone. It feels great to be fed and to share and feed someone. Serving someone a meal in your home or taking them to your favorite bagel spot is a wonderful experience. And teaching people to fish gives them freedom and autonomy. It empowers them to choose what kind of fish they want to catch and how to prepare it. That's nice. That's good. And teaching people to organize ensures that people have the ability to demand the changes they need later on. Throughout the Gospels, we see Jesus do all of these things. He does all three. Here, he feeds people directly, free of charge, without them even having to ask. And we do see him giving some fishing advice throughout the Gospels when he tells them to cast the net to the other side of the boat and to push out into the deeper water. Jesus does plenty of teaching about what it means to fish, how to fish more effectively. And we see Jesus organizing people in a certain sense. That's sort of what Jesus' whole thing was about. He offers us the vision of the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom, if you will, giving us a new way of thinking about communities of justice and care and joy. At the communion table, I would argue that we also do all three. We eat and are fed, freely offering to everyone who would come to this table. We are taught how to eat as we speak the ancient words of institution that remind us what it means to receive grace at this table, what it means to encounter the living Christ at this table. And we are offered a vision of what community can and should be. All of it, as it turns out, is grounded in relationships. We are in relationship to the people in this sanctuary, obviously. We're in relationship to the people who labored to provide the bread and fill the cup and set the table. We are in relationship with Christ, who is present among us, working in ways that are at once simple, down to earth, and miraculous. One of the things I love most about my Spokane bagel is that I buy them every week from the same guy. He knows my name. He asks how things are going. We have a bit of a relationship. As followers of Jesus, I believe we are called to the same ministry of healing, reconciliation that Jesus shows us throughout Scripture. It's grounded in relationship. As we gather at this communion table today, and as we look forward to beginning a new church year in September, if you can think that far ahead, I want to invite you to really reflect on what it means to be in relationship with our community, what it means to serve our community, and to think about what it means to teach, to organize, to invite deeper, more meaningful relationship in this community and in our wider community. Jesus gave people fish and bread to eat. I think those two elements are important because Jesus knew that bread and fish didn't keep very well. He knew that it was better to share those gifts with everyone than to hoard them for ourselves, to let them sit on the shelves. What are we doing to feed and serve people right here in Spokane? Where might we be called anew into direct action to meet the needs we see around us right now? And you don't have to look very hard. We donate water, warm clothes, sunscreen to meet the needs of people who cannot wait until we've had time to make the kind of change our society demands and deserves. But how can we be doing more? What are we missing? Who else might we be serving? And how do we start to build those relationships so that our service can be truly meaningful? What Jesus does is meaningful because he saw the hunger on the people's faces and he responded. Jesus taught people how to fish He challenged them to push out into the deeper water, to try fishing on the other side of the boat. What can we be doing to support one another, to show one another the way, to support our neighbors, and even people we don't think of as our neighbors? How can we deepen our own understanding and empower people to do more for themselves and for their communities? How can we give people the tools they need to live more fulfilling lives? Is there some sort of outreach that we haven't imagined yet that we can do to share some of the wisdom, some of the knowledge we have in this place? Finally, Jesus gave people a vision of what the kingdom of God looked like. Jesus showed people a different way of being together in community, a different way of taking care of each other, one that wasn't grounded in what we think people deserve, but that was grounded in what Jesus shows us we all deserve, which is the love and care that we need as children of the living God. Jesus built a radical community where nothing was owned privately and everyone was cared for, no matter how much they were able to contribute. How do we stand in solidarity with people and work to make that vision a reality? Which organizations can we be partnering with to lift our voices a little louder to demand that systemic change that makes sure that no one in Spokane or Washington or anywhere goes hungry? Jesus doesn't call us to high-minded theology. Jesus doesn't call us to be greatly skilled anglers or public policy wonks or anything of the sort. Jesus calls us to be radically engaged in the work of community with one another, in work that connects us more deeply to each other and to the people around us. It is that simple. It's difficult to see because so many of us have food in the refrigerator and in the cupboards, but we need one another. And so as we come to this table today to be fed and refreshed, reminded of who and whose we are, and as we go from this table into the world, I pray that we would leave changed. We come to this table as individuals, welcomed, called by name, but we are meant to leave as a community that is one body whose name is Christ. As we leave this community, we are meant to return to this table in deeper community and communion with all people and with all creation, those we see at the table and those we do not yet see at this table. How we do that must change in every season. There's a season for charity, a season for fishing lessons, and there's a season for organizing. The task of this community must be to discern the seasons wisely, to see where there are opportunities for us to be breaking bread with the vulnerable, the marginalized, and where we can be helping to build knowledge and power. All of that is possible only when we are in connection with people, looking them in the eye, knowing what they need, what they hope for, and daring to ask what they've been denied. Jesus knew that the people beside that lake needed food. They needed fish and bread, and they needed to eat it together. As disciples of Christ, we are called to know and learn what Spokane needs, to look our neighbors in the eyes and to know their hopes and their dreams. May we do it with that same spirit of abundance that Jesus did. May we offer ourselves to this world anew and share all that we have with this community, trusting that God's abundant spirit will provide, holding nothing back, firm in the conviction that it is better to share fresh bread than to let it go stale on a shelf. And nobody wants to deal with fish that's been kept around. Amen.